In a previous video, I showed you how to set up a basic leads method chart, and today it's time to add some more information to this chart to make it more useful for you in finding out how these matches relate to you. Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Fanatics, where we help you understand your DNA, climb your family tree, and write your ancestor story along the way. Today, we're going to be talking about the leads method chart and some of the extra information that you can add to it in order to make it so that you can identify how these matches may be related to you. With any basic tool, we always want to see what other things we can add to make this more useful and speed up the process of research in a lot of cases. Now, if you've had experience with genetic genealogy, you can put in the comments below some other information that you may have already added to your leads chart or that you think might be useful to add to it in order to make this a better tool. Today, I'm going to give you some ideas of some other information that I use on my leads charts in order to help me in my research. The first thing that I always add to my leads chart is I'm going to include a column that has the Centimorgan information and a column that has some relationship information. And while I may not know what that relationship is right away, I'm going to record that as soon as I'm able to figure it out. So here, what I've done is I've added column B, which is the Centimorgan information, and I've added column C, which is the relationship information. I haven't changed anything else about this chart. So all of the matches are in order from the largest down to the smallest. And you can see on this, I went actually below 90 centimorgans for some of these. Some of these are probably much more distant relationships. But what I wanted to do is I wanted to make sure that I had enough information in my groups in order to do further research. Now, if you're looking carefully, you'll see that I have what I call just the relationship abbreviation column, and I have the relationship column. And what I'm going to do later is I'm going to actually show you how I use both of these columns. In one of them, I just have a quick abbreviation of the relationship, like 1C for first cousin, whereas in the relationship column, I'll actually list the names of how that match is related to a common ancestor and how I or whoever I'm working on this for is related to a common ancestor. But this information is really useful because what we can see is a couple of things here. First off, I'd mentioned that these three people were first cousins or first cousins once removed. Well, if we were just going by these centimorgans, 400 centimorgans, we wouldn't have included Becky at all because she's above 400 centimorgans. However, we would have included Linda and Cole. They are well below that 400 centimorgans, but because I actually know these relationships, I'm actually going to put that information in here. Now, Becky, I know, is a first cousin once removed. Linda is also a first cousin once removed. And Cole is Linda's grandson. He is a first cousin three times removed to the target person of this whole leads chart. The next thing that I want to do is I want to get these color groups in order. In other words, I want to put all of the maroons together and put all of the teals together so that I actually have these groups together as opposed to being spread out all over the chart. That's going to help me see them a lot better. So here you can see what I've done is I have actually moved these around. Now, some programs you can actually sort by the color for that column. In other programs, like in Docs, what you have to do is you actually have to grab that column and move it around, and then it will move around wherever you want it to. But however you do it, you can see that I have these groups basically all together. Now, you will probably notice that what do we do with some of these people like Kellen or Charlie or Linda that fall into three groups? If we're trying to put the groups together, what can we do for them? Well, that comes to our next step of adding information is I want to now prioritize these individuals with multiple color groups. Now, how am I going to prioritize those individuals? Well, let me show you what I have done. So looking at Kellen and Pamela right here, what I want to do is I want to decide which group is the primary group, the number one group, and which one is the secondary group, the number two group. And in order to do that, I need to look at the lead person and how much DNA they share with the lead person, whichever one they share the most with. So, for instance, this orange group, Joe was the lead person. So Kellen actually shares more with Joe than Kellen shares with Deborah. And that is why Kellen is orange for the number one group. And then I've labeled the teal as the number two group. Same thing with Pamela. I have also put her in the orange group because she shared more DNA with the lead person of the orange group than she shared with the lead person of the yellow group. So I'm going to do that with all of my people who have more than one color. Now, why do you think you might have more than one color? Well, it's because your leads chart's probably not perfect. In other words, you probably don't necessarily have four groups. In this case, I have five groups, which if I only have four grandparents, and that means that two of these groups at least are from the same grandparent. That can happen when your lead person is not a second cousin, but rather a third cousin. And so that group is really representing a great grandparent, not a grandparent. Now that I have everybody prioritized, the next thing I want to do is go through and identify anybody in the group that is closely related. How am I going to find this out? Depending on which website you're on, some of them will give you information. For instance, 23andMe and MyHeritage will tell you how closely related though the matches are. So you might find that some of these people are siblings, or they might be first cousins, or there might be a grandparent and grandchild. That information is going to have to come from the website. Other websites like Ancestry don't give you that information, and so you may not be able to include it, or you may come across it as you're doing more research. So here on my chart, what I have done is I've gone through and I found that some of these people are children. For instance, Sarah is the child of Deborah. And if you actually look at it, it's pretty cool because Sarah shares about half the amount of DNA with Mike, who is the overall target person, as Deborah does. Also found out that Larry, Logan, and Russell are all children of Estelle. Now there's a problem there because Estelle only shares 50 centimorgans, but these others share 60 centimorgans. So they may actually be related through their father as well as their mother. But in each of these I've gone through and I have put the children next to the parents. And for each one of these children, I've put a C in there. Now the reason why we want to identify these close relationships is because, particularly with children, we don't need to then go and research the children if we've already got the parents' information. So in other words, I can find the parents' tree and I already know what the child's tree or what the grandchild's tree is. Likewise, if I have a set of cousins that I found, two or three cousins, well, once I've figured out who the grandparents of those cousins are, I may not know who the particular parents of them are, but I know who the grandparents of every single one of them is. And so finding these close relationships is helpful as we're going through and identifying how these relationships relate to us. Now, so far, all of this information that we have used to fill in this chart has just been from the DNA. Now it's going to be time to go and find some more information. What we want to do now is we want to actually identify who these common ancestors might be. And people that put trees online are a great resource as the first step in figuring out who that common ancestor is. In many cases, for second and third cousins, you're only looking back to grandparents or great-grandparents. And so most of that information probably is going to be accurate because it is very recent and based on personal knowledge of the people creating the tree or their close family members. Here is my final chart, and what you can see is I've gone through and I've included the relationships for all those known relationships. I've included some that I don't know the relationship, but I know part of how that fits. And I've labeled in the relationship column each of these known relationships, whether they're first, second, third, fourth cousins in some cases. And you can see that because I went below that 90 centimorgans, I actually have some fourth cousins on this table. For each one of these, what I have is I have two lines. I have one line that is the path between my match and their most recent common ancestor or ancestral couple, and from another target person and that most recent common ancestor couple. I've also included some information in the notes column, for instance, other relationships that they may have. So I was talking about finding some first cousins between different people. Here's a set of people who are first cousins, and then there's a grandchild of one of the people among that. So this whole group of people is going to be looked at together as opposed to each one individually. So what I'm doing with all of this information is I'm taking and I'm forming the groups initially with the colors, but then I'm trying to form other groups within those colors to help isolate a little bit further how they're related. Now you can see across the top, because of just this information I've gathered from some trees, I have been able to identify where these colors fit in with most of my grandparents. So for instance, this yellow, that corresponds to this person's paternal grandfather. Now the others, you'll notice, are not for a paternal grandmother. I didn't actually have any matches that could be attributed to a paternal grandmother. These other four, though, can be attributed to a maternal, either grandfather or grandmother. So depending on how they're related. Now I've been able to basically look at the teal and the orange and figure out which the grandfather and the grandmother from that. But with the green and the maroon, I don't yet know which one goes with which side. Based on some of these shared matches, for instance, Thomas, he shares the maroon and the teal, then that might mean that the maroon is also from the maternal grandfather, just another generation back. The other thing that we can then see with these is how first cousins complicate a leads chart. So for instance, I can see that Becky shares three colors, the maroon, the teal, and the orange. Now it turns out that the teal and the orange are two of the maternal grandfather and the paternal grandmother, and the maroon is also on the maternal side. Since she is a first cousin, we're going to be related through a common set of grandparents. So that's why we have both of those grandparents identified with Becky. Now, as you're going and dividing this out, unless your grandparents are related, what you shouldn't see is you shouldn't see that the maternal side is also got the same color as the paternal side. If it is, then you might have some connections in your family that you didn't know about before because of intermixing with these populations. I haven't actually seen that on mine because I know that each of my grandparents actually come from four really distinct lines. So once you have this done, then there are some things to be aware of. For instance, I have Deborah here. Deborah is my lead for the maroon group. I don't know how Deborah is related yet. However, if I do find out that Deborah is in fact a first cousin, well then I don't necessarily want to use her. I would want to use somebody else. However, I'm fairly certain she's not a first cousin. One, because the number of centimorgans is low enough, but also because she only shows one color, not multiple colors from this group. The other thing that you can always do is you can always add new people in. And that is what I like about this. So I can add people in to any color group once I find them. And what's easy is I just have to find which lead people they match with. So for instance, I may have had this match Julie that I wanted to add in later because she didn't show up initially. Well, by looking at Julie compared to Joe and Mabel and Deborah, I can see that she matches Joe. And so she's going to go into the orange group. So I will periodically update these with my new matches as well. And that gives me some information now about what line I should be looking on for that new match. So for instance, this Julie, I know I want to be looking at the Harper line of my research if I'm going to be looking for Julie, because she fits with the other Harpers that I've already found. There is probably a lot more information that you could add to a leads chart. And that's what's great about having these tools, is that everybody puts their own little spin on them and finds different uses for different information. So that's why I want you to tell me in the comments below what information you may add to your leads chart that you find valuable and how you use that. Now, if you haven't created a leads chart before, then watch the preceding video and this video so that you can understand how to create a leads chart. And use that in your research because it is a simple way to help divide up your matches into those different grandparent groups. Be sure to subscribe to our channel, and if you want to join, then click on the join button, and for just $2.99, you're going to be able to see all the different perks and extra videos and trainings and live streams that we do for our channel members.